show them what you're worth. Make them go, as you shoot across the sky.
All right, everyone, this is Miss Carmack. I am a STEM coach here at the high school. So if you don't know me, this is me. And actually, you can probably see me up here somewhere, but Olympia is who's on screen right now. She's our star for today. She is a renowned author. She's a scientist, mathematician, motivational speaker. And she is really excited about being here today at Reach virtually with us. And she wants to share with you her story. She hasn't always been sitting on this red chair, but she has worked really hard to get to this point, and she knows that you can be successful as well in any way that you want to be. And with some of her tips and tricks and also her story, and also she's going to share with you some of the books that she's wrote. And this is also going to be a surprise to Olympia, but Reach has purchased 25 copies of Olympia's books that are in Sora. So Olympia, as of today, your books are available for all of our students to be able to read and access through Sora. So you can talk a little bit about those too, and that way they know what each of those books is about. All right, so Olympia, you're still on mute, but I might need to unmute you. There you go.
Yes.
You got there. You now I can hear you. So yeah, that was exciting news, right? So you guys have access to that. And as far as the chat for Olympia's presentation, just so that we don't get distracted, I'm going to take the chat away. But once we are into the question portion of everything, I will allow you guys to send questions directly to me. And then I will kind of sort through those and I will post those questions to Olympia. And then at the final part of everything, I'll let you guys chat again. That way you can ask Olympia your own questions and just give her your thanks and all those other things that you wanna do at the end. So that's kind of how things are gonna go. And we still have people joining, so I'll keep watching the waiting room as we get started here. But Olympia, is there anything else you need before you get started?
No, I think we're all good. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can hear you great. And I think we're good to go.
All right.
Thank you, Olympia. It's all yours.
How are you doing today? I am Olympia LePoint. And thank you. Thank you for taking the time out of your day to come to this particular talk to learn about how you can succeed in the future. Because what I'm going to share with you are three tips that allows you to succeed in all of your math classes, all of your science classes, and it will allow you to create the future that you want for yourself. Now, I know a lot of you are joining us right now. Some of you don't know what to expect, but that's okay. We're here for the next 20 minutes to get tips on how you can do extremely well in your schoolwork and to get your questions answered, to find out what you can do specifically at this moment in time so you create great scores, great grades, and you have fun doing it. Okay, if you know anything about my background, that's great. And if you don't, that's perfectly fine. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna share with you a little bit about my background so you know what I've experienced. Now, if you know anything about my background, you know I helped launch 28 NASA space shuttle missions into space. That was Columbia, Endeavour, Discovery, Atlantis space shuttles. Now, that was back in 1998, all the way through, 2007. And the space shuttle retired in 2011. Now, we see new space shuttles going into the outer space, but it's not space shuttles. It's the Crew Dragon SpaceX vehicles that NASA sends out astronauts on. And what I did for the space shuttle program is I used mathematics and science to calculate the probability of catastrophic explosions within launch. Now, I know what I said sounds huge and long, and I'm going to just break it down to you in a way that makes extreme amount of clear sense. I used math and science to make sure people were safe when they launched on the rockets. And my time of doing that was not easy. It was probably one of the hardest jobs I have ever encountered in my entire life. But the great news is, what I learned during that experience, I was able to take with me for the rest of my life. But getting to that point of being able to launch rockets and help people stay safe when they go out in outer space was tough at first for me, because little do people know, even though I use mathematics and science to go into outer, launch people into outer space and help with space launches, I failed algebra, I failed geometry, I failed calculus, and I failed chemistry. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, what? How could she become a rocket scientist when she's failed so many classes? That doesn't make sense. Well, what I had to do is I had to take the classes over. And no one likes taking classes over, especially in summer school. And what I also had to do is reprogram my brain so I can actually solve problems. Now that was the hard part. And what I learned in doing that, I was able to not only ace calculus when I went to college, I was able to teach mathematics and science at the college level and launch rockets into outer space, all when I reprogrammed my brain. Now, there's a process to actually reprogramming your brain. And what I'm going to do today, and I hope you have your notes, I hope you have your piece of paper in front of you, I hope that you have a pen, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you something great. And I'm actually going to let you take the next couple of seconds, go get a pen, go get a piece of paper. I want you to come back and be ready to get this information. I'm going to count down. I'm going to count down from 20. And during that 20 seconds, I want you to get a piece of paper. I want you to get a pen. 20, 19, 18, 17, 16, 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, I hope you have your papers, 5, 4, 3, 2, are you ready? 1. Okay, what we're gonna do is we're going to learn the 3 tips that I'm going to share with you that I learned to reprogram my brain. And this comes from, I'm gonna hold my book up here so you see it. This comes from my first book, Mathaphobia, How You Can Overcome Your Math Fears and Become a Rocket Scientist. So I list all of these, I list a lot of tips in this book. And if you are in school, if you need to do well in your math classes and you didn't do that well before, this book is for you. So I'm just gonna share with you 3 tips. Number one, you have to realize no matter what you've gone through, you can always succeed. Now you're like, what, how is that possible? No matter what you have gone through, you always can succeed. Now, I came from South Central Los Angeles, so close to South Central Los Angeles. And there was gang violence and there was shooting and it was like really tough. And we didn't have any money to eat food some days. And I would go purposely to school just so I could get a meal. And I did not have the best upbringing. It wasn't even safe. And if you watch my TED talk, you know what I went through in order to just go to school. But the great news is that I didn't let that stop me. No matter what type of lack of money that I was experiencing and my family was experiencing, no matter the failing grades that I got, no matter what tough things I went through in my own house, I made a decision. I made a decision that no matter what I was going to go through, I was going to learn from it so I could help people from what I've learned. No matter what you go through, no matter what tough situations you encounter as a kid, whether your parents are getting divorced, whether when your parents have been laid off, or if someone's going through a pandemic, you can still succeed. No matter what you've gone through, no matter what you are going through, you can do well. But it's a decision that you have to make. It doesn't just fall out of the sky. It's a decision that you make to actually make something of your life. No matter what you go through, failing grades, failing bad test score, it doesn't matter, because when you decide that you're going to succeed, no matter what is thrown at you, that is the brain power that allows you to beat the odds, meaning do things that people would never anticipate that you could do. And it's because you have decided to do it. So no matter what you've gone through in the past, no matter what you will go through, you can still meet your goal with the decision to always move forward no matter what. Okay, here's the second tip. Are you ready for this? I hope you're writing this down, because I want to hear from you. I want to hear from you to find out which one of these characters most likely is you. I found out that when people are scared of mathematics, they become scared because they become fearful and they take on what I call a mathophobia character. Now you're like, what is she talking about? Okay, in my book, Mathaphobia, I'll hold it up again so you can see it. In my book, Mathaphobia, I talk about mathophobia, which is a severe fear that happens in the brain that shuts off our frontal brain lobes. And it happens in the reptilian part of the brain. And what happens is that when we're scared, when we're going through tough emotional challenges, when we're even looking at math and we don't know how to do it, our frontal brain lobes turn off because the amygdala part of our brain fires. Now, what that part of the brain is responsible for, it's responsible for you staying safe. So if you're in a stressful situation or a scary situation, you do one or two things, actually three things. You freeze up, or you flee, meaning you run away, or you fight back. And that's the natural response that every human has when they're scared. Every single person on the face of the planet experiences fear. You're no different. I'm no different. I get scared every day. I have to reprogram the way that I think. But when we experience any type of fear, it shuts off our frontal brain lobes. And our frontal brain lobes are responsible for us solving problems, whether it be learning how to do a new computer program or learning a new way of doing something or even solving a math problem. If our frontal brain lobe is not working, we become stalled and we can't find answers. And there's four type of people that we become when we're scared. And the first person is Quincy the quitter. He'll quit before he even tries. There's Donna the overdoer. She'll try and try and try, and she'll still miss the mark because she doesn't necessarily know how or what to do. There is Samuel the struggler. People have called him slow or have learning disabilities, but really he's smart, but he doesn't know how smart he is. And then the last person is Crystal the criticizer. She'll point the fingers and blame everyone for her poor performance. Now, every single one of us, when we're scared and when we don't know what to do, fall into one of these categories. And it doesn't have to just be with math. It can be with anything. Have you ever seen somebody when they get scared, they blame someone else because they don't know how to say, I made a mistake? Or do you know somebody who's really talented and then you just wonder why they don't even try when you know that they can be really good at something? It's because they're experiencing a mathophobia. It's a severe fear of solving a problem. So when we are first able to understand how we are dysfunctionally looking at a situation, and when we understand which character we are, then we can actually make steps to change it. Now, what I talk about in my book is a three-step process to change it. First, you have to identify what fear category you fall into. And then, and I have that test on my website, mathophobia.com, where you can take the self-test. And then from that, you can then start reprogramming your brain with the opposite of the fear. And then the third step is you actually have to do something. So you rewire your brain from the inside out. So it starts actually firing in a new way. So you are no longer scared and you take action to solve your problem. So for me, in high school, I was down to the overdoer. I would study all the wrong things and I would fail the tests. We all go through things. Well, for me, I realized that I had to find out how to read the tests and work with people. I had to work with a tutor who was a teacher who volunteered his time during the winter break to teach us. And when I caught the bus 2 hours each way just to sit with him for 1 hour, I realized I could actually overcome my fear. I could create a new way of seeing myself as a courageous person who could actually solve the math problems. So that's what I did. I started reprogramming my brain. Like when I would open up the book and I think, oh my God, this is hard, I'd stop and go, no, that's something Donna would say. So each one of the characters when they think differently, they have different ways that they look at the situation. For example, Quincy the quitter, when he looks at situations differently, becomes David the determined. Donna the overdoer that is overwhelmed and doesn't know what to do becomes Sarah the strategist because she finds out how to look at the problems and what to study. Samuel the struggler becomes Ivan the innovator. He's able to look at things differently, the way that no one else can see it, because his brain works differently and that's what he knows is his gift. And the last person, it's Crystal the criticizer, when she reprograms her brain, becomes, get this, Ellen the explorer. She goes out and she finds new things and she's not scared to become a beginner again. So when you're able to know what fear you're experiencing, you can name it so you can like reject it and realize that's not me. I am Ivan the innovator. I create great stuff. And all of us can do that. Every single one of us. It doesn't matter your age. You can be 7 years old. You can be 13. You can be 16. You can be in college. You can be a parent. It doesn't matter. And it doesn't matter your age, you can always succeed. And here's the last tip for you. I hope you're writing this down because what I'm about to share with you is going to be the most important thing that you can do. Are you ready? Here's the third tip for you. Start looking at the future and seeing yourself do exactly what you want to do. Seriously, start looking at yourself in the future. Do you want to become a politician? Do you want to become a fashion designer? Do you want to become a scientist like myself? Whatever you do, see yourself doing it. And observe yourself. Take a look at what you're doing. Like, for example, when I saw myself launching rockets, I was 9 years old. I was actually daydreaming and I was thinking to myself, what could be something really hard that I can do that will be able to really help people? And that's when the Challenger explosion happened. If you ever know about Challenger, I know some of your parents know about Challenger. That's when the space shuttle exploded. And I was 9 years old. And after seeing that, I told myself, someone has to do something really powerful so people can save their lives when they launch rockets. And I decided to see myself at a desk launching rockets and writing the mathematics on this piece of paper so I could help launch rockets. I had no idea that 20 years later, from that vision of seeing myself do that, I had no clue that I was defining my future by envisioning it and then taking the steps to actually get there. Okay, the reason why this works actually is from my third book, and this is the book that's out now, Answers Unleashed 2, The Science of Attracting What You Want. And this is actually for you and your parents. When you can actually see yourself doing something in the future, you become connected to yourself. Albert Einstein called it quantum entanglement, meaning when two objects meet or they observe one another, they somehow become combined. They take on the positive characteristics of one another and they move forward with them. So when you envision yourself in the future doing great things, you are jumping through time and seeing yourself. And as you observe yourself, you get a chance to see the steps that it takes to be successful in that role. And then whatever you see yourself doing, like for example, if you see yourself as a successful business owner, what are you doing? You're writing checks, you're hiring people, and you're spending the time to know how to bring in income, what great qualities exist in people that know that where you know that they're loyal employees. Whatever characteristic that you see yourself doing in the future, you start learning that now. And as you start learning that now, you become connected and connected and connected and connected with who you want to be. So if there's anything you take from this talk, remember my 3 points. Number one, you can do anything no matter what you've gone through. Number two, you have to know your fears so you can actually reprogram your brain. And third, you have to start seeing yourself do exactly what you want and start taking those actions today so you meet your future. I hope this talk has helped you today. And for more information, you're always able to go to my websites, answersunleashed.com and mathaphobia.com. And I love sharing science with you. I am Olympia LePoint, and I'd love to take your questions today.
All right, that was awesome, Olympia. Thank you so much. That, you know, those are excellent tips, and I do hope everyone wrote those down. I'm going to give you guys a few minutes. I'm going to open this up. You can send me questions. Your questions are only going to come to me. So remember, I can see who's sending them. I will then pull questions and I will ask you, Olympia. And then after kind of we're all done, I'm gonna open up the chat for everybody and encourage you guys to turn on your cameras. That way Olympia can see all your beautiful faces and put a face with the name. So here you go, here's your questions. Go ahead and type them in now. And as I get them in, I will start to read them to you, Olympia. So your the three books that we'll have in the library, then, if you want to just quickly talk about those, you have the Mathaphobia, the Answers Unleashed, the original, and then Answers Unleashed 2.
Yeah. And this video, thankfully, from your school is going to be available online, and it's going to be on the mathaphobia.com website and available for anyone to watch. So the great news is that your school has created this opportunity for you to get this information no matter where you are. So the first book that I was telling you about, I recreated the, it's like a self-help science educational book series. And I wrote 3 books and I'm gonna briefly tell you the names and tell you what they're about. The first book, this is Mathaphobia. If you can see how pretty it is, this is like the first book I ever wrote. I look young here because I was. this book, Mathaphobia, How You Can Overcome Your Math Fears and Become a Rocket Scientist, is a great book because it helps you overcome your fear of math so you actually do well in the science fields. And the science fields is the fields that are STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. So you'll hear that a lot, the word STEM, and that's what that stands for. So that's the first book. The second book is this beautiful red cover, and it matches actually the seat I'm in. This cover, if you can see really close, do you see what's in the background? Who could guess what that is in the background? That's like it's like a cross between neurons in the brain and space. Meaning this book, Answers Unleashed, The Science of Unleashing Your Brain's Power, is a book to help you rewire your own brains so whatever past fears that you have, you can actually use it to create innovation. And this book is for people who have gone through the toughest moments and they want to find out how they can change the way that they're thinking about situations so they take all that chaotic energy and put it towards innovation. So that's this book. And I liken the background here, like the firing, like how space is so vast. That's how our brain works. One dendrite, and dendrite is like the connection in our brain, houses more information than the entire World Wide Web. And you have billions of those connections in your head. So your brain is more powerful than you know. And this book talks about how powerful your brain is.
Awesome. Olympia, just real quick, so we're getting some great questions. I'm going to kind of combine some. We had do you have any role models or mentors? So basically, kind of what inspired you to get to the point where you're now an author? We heard kind of your story from, you know, scientist, mathematician, tutor, but how did you end up becoming an author and motivational speaker for other people?
One mentor and just really good friend I have is my friend, retired astronaut, Robert Kirby. And I originally met him, it was at a space launch. It was like back in 2003 or 2004, I forgot which year. And I was at a work trip and I remember just meeting him. And I remember thinking to myself, that is so cool that he's gone to space. He was thinking, oh, that's so cool that she built a rocket. I mean, that is like the way I was thinking about it. And I just watched, he's a little bit older than I am. And I just started watching on what he did to change the way in which he was thinking. Now, obviously when you go into space, you go into the most craziest situations. And if you know his story, he had to actually save his crew members in space. And that's a story that's on Discovery Channel and everything. But it was like amazing because I started thinking, well, what could I do? I was so impressed that there was a African-American astronaut. And I thought to myself, what can I do as a woman of color to help other people gain the type of thinking that you could go into rocket science and launch and be an astronaut, or you can be a rocket scientist. And I decided to create this series because there were so few people that look like myself, meaning there were so few young people, there were so few women, and there were so few people of color that was in that environment. I thought, well, how about helping people understand the science so they can contribute in a magnificent way so all of us together can create solutions? And so that was actually what led me to write my books.
That's awesome. So I love this question. This question comes from, let me see, it's Adrian, I believe. It's taking a little minute here, but she asked, how many times do you have to take the same math class over? You talked about failing or not doing well in math. So I think that's relatable for some of our students that struggle with math. So I do like that question.
So repeat the question again. It's like, what did I do?
Did you have to retake? How many times like did it take you to finally pass math and get through math?
Oh, a lot. I laugh now because I launched 28 rockets, but no, it took a lot. I had to take over algebra. I had or don't know, I had to take over geometry. I had to take over calculus in college. And I had to take and understand chemistry. And then I actually taught algebra at the community college level. So to a grown adults who wanted to master algebra too. So you can learn math at any age.
Awesome. All right, thank you for that. So here's, let's see. What was the most difficult spot for you now that you can kind of reflect on all of it to where you are right today? What has been the most difficult part of your journey that you were able to kind of overcome and then move forward with?
If anyone watched the movie Hidden Figures with Katherine Johnson and Mary Jackson, if anyone watched that movie, that is similar to what I went through 30 years later. It wasn't much different. And being a woman and being a woman of color, where it was completely different than the environment in which I was asked to contribute into, I had to overcome a lot of barriers. I had to overcome many barriers. And I had to introduce to people that it was great to work with a woman. It was great to see things in a different light based on a different way of thinking based on culture. And I had to introduce that it was great to understand from someone who was young, and it was great to understand from someone who was about to retire. There's all sorts of diversity in this world. There's diversity of people and their backgrounds. It's the diversity of their education and their age and disabilities, and the list goes on and on. And when we can learn from people, we really become powerful because we understand where someone's coming from, and that gives us strength. And then we're able to solve problems in a new way because the problems no longer are problems because we found answers on multiple levels. And for me, I had to find the answer on how I could contribute to an environment and be heard as a young woman of color. And it was successful because I helped win our group, helped win $55 million in new engine contracts. And I was very thankful because through that opportunity, I won Modern Day Engineer of the Year. And it was learning to break the stereotypes that people have when it comes to science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. No matter what you go through, you can be a success. Laurie?
Thank you. So there's so many good questions, but I this is an interesting one to me. Someone asked, Ronaldo, I believe, he asked if there was another career path that you thought about prior to going into math and science.
Yeah.
Or if you kind of always wanted to do that and there was never another question. Was there something else that you saw yourself doing at some point?
Oh, yeah. I saw myself doing a whole lot of stuff. Rocket science was one of them. We can have multiple things in front of us. Like I saw myself teaching as a professor, which I eventually did do. And I saw myself being a news broadcaster. And I was thinking to myself, well, how can I do all of that? I just don't understand. Well, anytime you have an expertise and you write books and you learn something really well, you can actually share about it on the news. And so I'm very fortunate because when I saw myself as a newscaster and when I saw myself as a journalist when I was young, I didn't realize studying and completing my degrees in college with my bachelor's degree and master's degree, that was going to enable me and give me the confidence and knowledge to present information on TV. So I'm very thankful because I got a chance to share information on CBS 2 News here in Los Angeles about the SpaceX launches. And I've been on TV sharing information on Amazon Prime, on, boy, a lot, TED Talks and Impact Theory and all these different things. And I saw myself being on TV. And I didn't know that one of the best ways to contribute to the media is through education. So you actually get answers and that those answers are entertaining.
Awesome. So we have the time for a few more questions here. This one's from Simone. He said, or she said, I'm not exactly sure because I don't have the thing here, but you mentioned growing up in a rough environment. Any specific advice for how you could tell students to get past the distraction of dysfunction or chaotic home life so that they can focus on their goals?
Oh, that's a great, brilliant question. I thank you so much for that question. It's like, how do you handle really tough environment? Like for me, when I was in, K through 12, kindergarten through 12th grade, I was in close to South Central Los Angeles. And to give you an idea how rough it was, I remember having our older sister bring us home from the dentist. And then we saw the yellow tape that the police and crime scenes have. And then our neighbor was injured by a gang member and he almost died based on that. And he was two houses down. And that was going home and not knowing if you were going to be alive as you stepped off the bus to walk back home. That's how tough it was. And in those type of situations, our fear in our brain kind of fires. And every time that fires, it's really hard for our frontal brain lobes to actually fire on and actually give us answers. So what I realized in my situation, what I need to do is do three things. One, I needed to write down what I needed to do. When you're in a tough situation, the best thing that you can do is write down your plans. I know that sounds odd, but the fact of you writing it down on a piece of paper, everything from what you plan to do that day, from everything to what you plan to do in the future, to even your homework assignments in a set place, because that gets you thinking of what you have to execute. When you're thinking about what you're going to do and what you're going to execute, that actually turns off the fear because your brain now is like, I'm not scared about the fear. I'm going to think about what I'm going to do. So writing that down is helpful. The second thing to do is helpful is always set a study time with somebody so you can study with somebody who's actually concerned about your education, whether it be a parent, whether it be an online tutor, whether it be a friend through Zoom. If you set a time every single day, like clockwork, to study math with somebody else, or just be on the phone at the same time as someone else is studying something else, you think you're not alone and you feel like you are together with someone, and that breaks the cycle of fear in your head. And the last tip I would do is if you have the opportunity to go to college, check out going to the dorms and stay on campus. And if you have that opportunity, that's great. If you don't, that's okay. If you don't have that, I tell you to check out the tutoring labs on your campus. This is why. Now, we're in the pandemic, so we're doing everything virtually. But if you have the ability to meet somewhere else that's safe, and it doesn't have to be inside, it can be like actually outside in an open area with mask on if you're in a pandemic, but in a normal situation, you can go to a tutoring lab and work with somebody in a tutoring lab, or you can have a set study place where you go to every week or every day. And that way, when you set yourself in a different environment, you start becoming calm and not allowing the environment that you have to go back to change the path in which is for your future. So that's the three tips that I would give in regards to that. And thank you, Laure, for that. What great, great, great question.
Yes, like I said, that came from Simone. And this question is interesting. It's from Konya. And it says, if you could go back and change something in your past, would you? Even if that's something is, you know, maybe a hardship that you faced, because ultimately it seems like that's kind of what made you who you are. Would you change anything about your past experiences given where you are today? Or would you keep everything the same?
That's a really good question. Now, don't get me wrong. I would like want to go back and go, why did I say that? Or like, I should have gone back. I should have done this. All of us do that. No, nobody on the face of the planet doesn't do that. But when I look back at all the things that I like didn't do right, there was a lot that I am not a perfect person. And I have learned so many times on the things that I need to do. So I actually create opportunities. What I learned is that it's okay if I didn't do something right the first time. And it's taken me years to accept that. It's not an overnight thing. But I realized that each time I didn't do something correctly and I had to go back or I made a mistake, it was almost like divine timing. It had to work out for the timing, because had that not happened, great things wouldn't be immediately after. Like, for example, I remember applying to USC. And if anyone knows USC, it's this University of Southern California. And I applied for aerospace engineering degree. And they just totally rejected my application. They're like, Olympia, who? They put it to the side. And I was like, oh! Then I went to California State University, Northridge. That was the best decision I could have ever made. It was a state school. It wasn't a private school. I did have to take out some loans, but it wasn't much. And turned to find out when I graduated, 5 years later with my undergraduate, I started working at the Boeing company. And that's where I ended up launching rockets. But how I got to the Boeing company is that one of my classmates started working at the Boeing company before I did. And so when I got there, or when I actually applied, he told the recruiting people, I was in class with her. She's smart. And that's how I ended up going to become a rocket scientist. Had I gone to the school that I thought I was going to go to first, it wasn't going to be beneficial for me because the timing wasn't going to be perfect. So what I realized is, as a 44-year-old person, because I know I look young, but I am a woman, is that when we go through these type of strange situations like that, and we wish we could have done something, all things work together for your good, as long as you really have the best intentions. And that's what always happens. So for me in my life, I've realized that I'm a work in progress. There's going to be things that I don't do correctly, and that's okay. I've just got to learn from them and move on. And when I do, the answer is going to be in front of me.
Laurie. That's excellent. Yes, definitely. Work in progress. That's what we all are. So it's about 3:45. So I'm going to just kind of give you two quick questions. One is, some of the students are asking, do one of your books stand out as your favorite one? And then to end it all, what is your proudest accomplishment given everything that you've done in your short life so far? what is your proudest accomplishment, and what is the book that you like to write the most? And then once Olympia finishes those, I'm going to open the chat up for everyone, and you'll be able to write your own messages to Olympia, and encourage you to turn your camera on so she can also see your face. Thank you.
Cool. Well, let's see. Do I have a favorite book? No, but I really am really happy about my most recent book. But all my books are like my kids. It's like asking if you have a favorite kid. Our parents really love their children. They have each of their children have different talents. And so you love them uniquely. I love the fact that I wrote my third book, Answers Unleashed 2, The Science of Attracting What You Want. And it's the 6 decisions for people to make. It's like a new secret decision-making science that I created to help people actually envision their future, not be scared of the future, but actually go to the future, jump to the future that they want, and then come back and make the 6 decisions to get there. And this is like my most exciting book. I'm really excited about it. I'm going to be giving a talk, a TED-like talk, complimentary for the first 1,000 people at California State University, Northridge, here in California. And it's open for people across the entire globe, really. And it's April 28th. And I'm really excited about giving this particular talk. And it's from my third book here. And I'm excited because it's a blue book. If you notice, my books it's red, white, and blue, which is like the American colors. People don't really know that, but that's what I do. A little thing for a little trick for myself to remember. Hey, but what I really, I'm really proud about, is not that I've written books. It's not that I launch rockets. It's not that I'm on TV and doing all this stuff. No. The real true thing I'm really proud about is that I finished my college degree. I finished and completed and earned my bachelor's of science degree in mathematics and my master's of science degree in mathematics. That in itself, that degree is more powerful than anything I can do, because that degree shows that I have earned every single thing that is in front of me now. And that is for you too. No matter where you are, your greatest accomplishment is going through school, doing as well as you can, enrolling in a four-year university or community college, and completing your university four-year degree. For me, that was the most important thing I could do in my life. And that, no matter what, I always have. I encourage you to do the same. I'm Olympia LePoint, and thank you so much for being here at this talk.
Thank you so much, Olympia. There were some other great questions. I'm sorry I couldn't get to all of them, but Olympia, if you want to open up the chat, I've opened the chat up to everyone. Students, you know, whoever's on here, you're feel free to write your messages of thanks to Olympia. And like I said, you can pop on the camera and wave and say hi. Oh, Olympia, that was awesome. Thank you so much. It's good to see you too. If I didn't say it at the beginning, Olympia and I met in college at Cal State. So Olympia was just a student, just like me, back when we met. And it's been really awesome to see everything she's been able to do in the time that we've known each other, which I'm not going to say. It's been a while, though.
We might as well say you're still young too. we both are alumni from California State University Northridge, and that when she asked me to speak, I'm like, of course. So I'm telling you, college is like the best thing that you could possibly do. You meet cool people that you know for the rest of your life.
Very true. It's a great place to meet people. You never know who you're going to meet in college. Again, not that you have to go to college, but meet people. It's a great thing. You just never know who you're going to meet and who they're going to become. So definitely take advantage of being social, especially after we can be more social here with as the pandemic starts to hopefully go away. But thanks everyone for coming. Like I said, I'll leave the chat open here for another minute or two. The recording, I'm going to send it to all the high school students, or Mrs. Swope will, and we'll also be sending that to the middle school. And then the recording will be available. The link will be available for that. It will take you to Olympia's site, and then you'll be able to watch the recording. You'll also be able to check out her educational materials, her books, and all the other stuff about her as well. And again, thank you. That was amazing.
Thank you. Thank you. It's my honor. And find me on social media. Find me on Instagram.
Yes, that's awesome. You can definitely follow Olympia there.
Go to Olympia LePoint Instagram. I'm on Instagram. Find me on Instagram. Say hi.
It's motivating too.
Find under a picture. I'll answer it.
It is very motivating, your Instagram, because it's always messages of motivation, just little things to just kind of brighten your day. So I do like seeing your posts on there.
Clever shots and all that good stuff. Well, it has been so fun. Thank you so much. Thank you. And find me on Instagram. And I don't have my glasses on. Otherwise, I'd be able to look at all of your notes, but I want to answer all of them. Find me on Instagram under Olympia LePoint. Parents, find me on Instagram. And I look forward to talking to you soon.